is where we'll focus our attention for a few minutes tonight. Matthew 21. I ran off and left my iPad at the house, so bear with me for a second. Matthew 21, we're continuing our thoughts in the parables, and Matthew 21 is home to quite a few. A few that you would be really familiar with, a few that would look like you would recognize and lend themselves to some pretty easy lessons. But then there are also some that may not be as easily recognizable. And sometimes in the Bible, we think about stories like that. Like some, you know, if you say, man, tell me a story about Jesus or Jesus healing. Well, then there are automatically places that we might go, like Chris talked about on Sunday night, the woman with the issue of blood and how she touched the hem of Jesus' garment and suddenly her ailments were gone, even after years of dealing with those ailments. But then there are others that could also illustrate the same point, but are far lesser known than maybe that passage. And Matthew 21 has some parables that are a lot like that. Like, especially when you hear the parable of the two sons, maybe your mind goes to Luke 15. Because even though we call that the prodigal son, a lot of times you know that it's not just home to a story about one son, that the father had two sons. One went away into a far country and one stayed at home. But Matthew 21's parable of the two sons is different. And it's different in a lot of ways. It's significantly shorter than that parable. But also I think it packs a pretty good punch, and is easily recognizable when you give your attention to it. So Matthew 21 is where we'll focus. We'll pick up in verse number 28 through verse number 32. It's just a short parable, but I want to pick that as our focus tonight. And what we've done over the last couple of weeks is look at the parable of the sower, and that's a big one. It's easily known. The lessons are pretty easy to take away from it, and so I tried from week to week to go lesser known to well known, lesser known to well known. So tonight's a little bit of a lesser known. Don't have any other announcements that were on the sheet. Maybe just one thing to make mention of is that CYC's next week, or Chisholm Youth Conference is this coming weekend, and so there's a shopping cart out there for drinks and snacks if you feel so inclined to donate that. Like I told you last week, if you've ever been around teenagers for any extended period of time, you know they eat and drink stuff all the time like crazy, so they would appreciate any of that. Just needs to be here by Friday at 9. They're headed out on that. Let's begin with a prayer, and then we'll get started. Father in heaven, we're thankful for the day. We're thankful for the privilege we have to be here together. Father, we're thankful for our family here at Chisholm Hills. We pray for each family unit represented. Father, we pray for each mom and dad, for each grandpa and grandma. We're thankful for each kid, for each person who makes up our family here at Chisholm Hills and all the various walks of life that are represented. Father, we're thankful for the experiences of faith that we have collectively in this place and how we can rely on each other. We can encourage each other, that there are so many experiences and circumstances in life that so many people have faced that they're able to mentor and to minister to people who are dealing with similar things. And Father, we're thankful for that. And we pray that we'll be humble enough to seek their guidance and their wisdom when we find ourselves in those situations, and that we'll be generous enough to pass it on when we might have an opportunity. Father, we're mindful of so many in our congregation that are hurting and that are sick, that are dealing with physical ailments of some sort. We pray for your care and compassion on them in whatever form that might be, Father. If it's healing them of their physical ailment, if it's giving them the strength to weather the storm, Father, maybe it's patience or the ability to persevere in trial, Father. So many ways we can handle our problems, and we just pray that we'll handle them in a godlike way, and most importantly, that we'll honor you in all seasons of our life, the ones that are painful and the ones that are good. Father, we're mindful of the time we have together tonight for us to study and for us to grow and hopefully look with a heart that is open and willing to being influenced by your word. And we know, Father, even if it's a passage we've read a million times, that if our hearts are inclined to learn from you, that you will, through your word, speak to us, that you'll help us to grow and you'll give us the things that we need to be more like your son, Jesus. It's in his name we pray. All right, parable of the two sons, Matthew 21. Let me set it up this way. I want to tell you two stories about two little boys. The first story about a little boy was first time at church. He had never been to church before. I don't know if he was invited by a friend or if his mom dropped him off, but he goes into this church building, and the way that they started their service at this church was by what we would know as something like pew packers. So all the kids were up at the front. The preacher, he was, you know, spouting off these Bible facts, and the kids would either recite them if they're learning them, or if it was their turn to tell him what it meant, they were saying. And this kid's just kind of sitting over there, not really knowing what was going on, intimidated by all the other kids who were answering, and he not knowing what to say. And it's almost like he was waiting on his moment to shine, like for an answer to come about that he knew the answer to so that he could say it. And it came when the preacher was giving a little bit of a devotional message, kind of. And I'm not really sure the nature of the message, but the preacher asked a question. He said, "Does anyone here know what a smoke alarm is?" And that boy's hand just went up. I mean, he was so excited that he finally got to answer. And the preacher says, "You know, what is a smoke alarm?" And he's like, "Well, it goes off, you know, when it's smoky." And he was like, "Well, when have you been around that?" And he was like, "Every time my dad cooks, smoke alarm goes off." And that's how he knew. He was quick to throw his dad under the bus, that every time his dad was doing some cooking, the smoke alarm went off. And I'm sure everybody laughed, and the kid maybe didn't mean anything by that, but surely he dissed his dad by telling on him in front of the whole church that every time he cooked, the smoke alarm went off. Let me tell you another story about a kid who had a hamster. At least he wanted a hamster. Every story I've ever heard about hamsters ended in a tragic way. I've told others about experiences I've had with hamsters and things of that nature, but you know, this kid, he promised his mom, "Mom, I promise if you get me a hamster, I'll take good care of it. I'll do every, like every kid promises, you know, "Mom, if you get me a dog, I'll water it, I'll feed it." Right, Mary Ellen, you know that. Don't you have a dog right now that's not yours, I think, you're keeping? Yeah, see, that's how it works. I promise I'll take care of it, and then the parents end up with it or something like that. Well, anyway, that's what happened with this little boy. He wanted a hamster, and the kids begged for it. They wanted it really bad. "Mom, we'll take care of it, we'll feed it, we'll clean the cage, everything." And after time goes on, the mom is taking care of it. And the funny thing about this hamster is they named him Danny. And after a while, mom says, "Danny's got to go. Danny has got to go. He's making a mess. Y'all aren't taking care of him." And the kids were just distraught, particularly this little boy. And he is just so upset that his mom says that Danny has to go. And he's like, but I don't understand. Like, he's been here all of our lives. Like, Danny's been around all of our lives. He means so much to us. We can't get rid of him." Mom's like, "Yes, he makes too much of a mess, and it's too much of a problem." And so the little boy says, "So you're telling me that if we can make him see that he makes too much of messes, if we can get him to clean up a little bit, then he can stay?" And mom was like, "No, get his cage. Danny has to go." And he says, "Oh, Danny, I thought you said Daddy." I tell you those two stories about dads, you know. Dads are always the ones we pick on and stuff. I pick on my dad a lot. I tell y'all about the way he talks and the things he says. And I started to tell you a story about him, but I knew he'd probably be watching and I'd get in trouble. So I told two fake stories about dads. But the reality is sometimes we diss and unintentionally, maybe some ways, disrespect dads. Not really. Those are jokes. But what happens in Matthew 21, 28 through 32, it wasn't a joke. The father was disrespected, really. And the way that these sons respond to the father, at least initially, one of them responded in a disrespectful way, but he came to his senses. And then the other one, he responded in the right way, but ultimately disrespected his father by the actions that he did or the lack of action that he took to answer his father's request. And so when we look at Matthew 21, 28 through 32, I want you to keep that in mind, that we're talking about a father who presented an opportunity to two sons, and ultimately he was disrespected. Matthew 21, let's read 28 through 32. What do you think Jesus is asking this group of religious elite, people that are challenging his authority? And you can even see that just in a few verses before. They ask Jesus, "What authority do you have," verse 23, "to do these things?" You remember that he, I guess it's the last week of his life, Matthew 21, the first 11 verses, it's his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, verses 12 through 17, he's overturning the money changers' tables in the temple, verses 18 really through about verse 23, he's asking these religious elite, these people, you know, why they attack him the way that they do. And they're like, "Well, why do you, you know, say you have all this authority. And instead of answering their question, maybe the way that they wanted him to, he asked them a question. He says, do you think that John's baptism, verse number 25, is from heaven or was it man-made? And the Bible even says in verse 25 that they discussed it among themselves. They said, if we say John the Baptist's baptism is from heaven, then we're in trouble because we didn't believe John the Baptist. But if we say it's man-made, then all the people are going to be mad at us because all the people really believe that John the Baptist was a great prophet. And so either way, we're in trouble. And they respond in verse number 26 and say, if it's man-made, we're afraid of the crowd because John considers everyone to be a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we don't know. And so Jesus says, well, then I'm not going to tell you by what authority I'm doing these things. And so then it's like he follows that up. Before they could ever answer again, before they could ever defend themselves, Jesus says, all right, what do you think about this? And you know we do that sometimes. It's like when we know what we want someone to say, and we know that we've got them right where they want them, so we give them this other scenario so they'll finally admit what we want them to see is true, and Jesus does that. He says, I've got you right. Well, you realize that if you say this, you're in trouble with me. If you say that, you're in trouble with the people. So the easy answer is we don't know, and Jesus says, but before we go any further, what do you think about this? And he tells this story. A man had two sons. He went to the first one and said, my son, go work in the vineyard today. And he answered, I don't want to. Some of your Bibles might say, I will not, in verse 29. But later he changed his mind and went. Then the man said to the other the same thing. And he says, I will, sir. He answered, but he didn't go. Which of the two did his father's will, Jesus asked. And they said, the first. And Jesus said, truly I tell you, tax collectors and prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God before you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. Tax collectors and prostitutes did believe him, but when you saw it, you didn't change your mind, and you didn't even believe him. So I guess as I read this story and I think about what Jesus is ultimately trying to communicate to these religious people, you could summarize it in this generic thought. And let this be the thought that fuels the rest of our discussion as far as what Jesus' message is concerned to these people, that what we do is far more important than what we say. And that's Jesus' problem with these two sons. And really the overarching theme that's happening in Matthew 21 as he reveals the hypocrisy in the hearts of these religious people that were constantly saying the right things, but what they said didn't match up with what they did. So the overarching theme that drives our thoughts with Matthew 21, 28 through 32 is this. What we do as Christians is far more important than what we say. So let's do this first. Let's glance at the two contrasts that are presented in the story. Those two contrasts are sons, right? You have this first son who says, I will not, when his dad says, I want you to go work in the vineyard. And then the other son says, I will. And there's a total difference in who they are and how they act based on their responses and what happens or ensues after the father has a conversation with them. So he goes to the first son, basically, and says, look, I have a job for you to do. I have some work that needs to be done. And so he says, son, I want you to go work in your vineyard today. And I'm struck immediately by the fact that he calls the boy's son. Like there were times in my life, and maybe you remember this when you were growing up, when your parents asked you to do something, there were times where my dad just said, hey, go do this. Or, hey, listen to this. But then there were also times where he said, son, now I want you to pay attention. Son, I need you to listen. Son, I need you to focus. And it's like when he used the word son, I knew two things. I knew that what he was about to tell me was out of love. Like he wanted me to listen and he wanted me to focus and he wanted me to get it. But I also know that he was showing me, hey, I have authority here and I'm using it. So it's like affection and authority are present in Matthew 21 and verse 28. When the guy says, son, there's some work that needs to be done today. In other words, it's a reasonable thing for this father to ask something of his son, but he's letting him know that I'm doing it because I love you, that what I'm asking you to do is driven out of affection, an intimate term of endearment, namely son. Son, I need you to get this work done today. Authority and affection are present in the task given to the son. And also notice this urgency too. He says, I need you to do it today. Like, I need this to be done. I guess I was trying to picture in my mind what that might look like for me. And really, I guess what makes it so appalling is the answer that he gives in verse 29. Like, I know how my dad would have reacted if I had said no when he asked me to do something. Or if even worse, like some modern translations like the CSB and others, it says in verse 29 that he answered, I don't want to. The Greek literally reads, no, I will not. So either way, you try that with your dad and see how that goes. He tells you to do something, you say, no, I will not. Or, no, I don't want to. Either one of those probably aren't going to fly in most of our households. Like, that would be a bad idea for us to say that. And so I read that and I'm thinking, what? This guy must not have been very bright. He must not have been thinking through the situation. If he's going to say that to his dad, if he's like my dad, was going to grab the closest thing he could get to him and get after his rear end, because he, you know, shouldn't say that to his dad. He should do what he asked him to do. But after thinking about it for a little while, obviously he changes his mind and he goes. And I thought about this. It's like, as I guess I see it more in my dad and his dad. If my dad has a full day, like he has a full day of work scheduled, but his dad calls him and says, hey, son, I have something going on, you know, in my shop. I need some help. You know, dad is very skilled in electricity, so a lot of times mammy and papa will come and say, hey, you know, the lights aren't working or something. Well, my dad will drop whatever he has on his schedule to go to his parents' house to do it just because it was his parents that asked. And it may be that when papa calls, dad's like, man, I can't today. I can't today because I have so much going on. I have all this stuff I need to get done. But then after he hangs up the phone, he thinks, man, it's my dad. It's my dad that called. You know, and so it's like at that moment, he changes and he goes and does what needs to be done just because it was his father who asked. That's what I think about when I read verse 28 and verse 29. This guy says, I won't. Maybe he's thinking, Dad, you know that I'm busy. You know that I have all this stuff. You know that I've got a full schedule of things to do. But then when he leaves the conversation, he's thinking, man, my dad asked me to do that. I really need to do that. Or maybe the father's affection, maybe the fact that his father said son and it made him feel like he was loved or appreciated, maybe that's what changed his mind. I don't know. Either way, you have this picture. The son says, no, I won't. But then he changes his mind and he follows suit with what his dad asked him to do. And he goes and he handles the work in the vineyard. Then the second son in verse number 30. His dad asked him the same thing. And I would assume that based on the text that says the same thing, he probably said to him, son, I have some work for you to do in the vineyard today. And he replies, yes, sir, right? Essentially, I will, sir. I'll do that. I'll do that because you asked me to do it. And on the surface, he's compliant. And so quickly we think, well, this guy must be a good son. He must be doing everything right. His faith, his respect of his father, it's got to be great because he said yes. But then you read on in verse number 30 and you read these words, but he didn't go. So the first son says no, but he went. And the second son says yes, but he didn't go. They have different answers, different attitudes, and different actions. While the son that was first was strong-willed and maybe had a busy schedule and was like, man, I can't do this, he eventually changes his mind. The other son talks a good game, but he stayed around the house. He talked the talk, we say sometimes, but he didn't walk the walk. Jesus then asked an obvious question. He says, which of these two did his father's will? Was it the first son who says, I won't, I don't want to, but then goes and does it? Or is it the second son that says, yes, I'll do it, but then never does anything? And these religious people, Matthew doesn't record it, but they did it just a few verses earlier when Jesus asked them a question and the answer was obvious and they knew that if they answered right, they were going to be wrong, at least right in the eyes of Jesus. And if they answered right in the eyes of the people, well, then they were going to be wrong too. And so maybe they're having this conference among themselves and they're finally like, okay, Jesus has got us. So they answer right in verse 30. They said the first son. And I know they didn't want to answer because then that meant that they were in trouble, that they were admitting that they were like the second son, that say all the right things, but they never actually do anything about it. And then you see how it transitions into these two groups of people. You have the tax collectors and the prostitutes, and then you have you, which are the religious elite people. And that's what he says. They will enter the kingdom of God before you. So he separates these two groups of people, and here they are, the two groups that are presented in Matthew 21, 28 through 32. You have the rebellious who repent, and you have the religious who rebel. And that's what Jesus classifies them as. He says, here you have tax collectors and prostitutes, which are basically, notoriously, the absolute scum of the earth, worst people that you could ever imagine. You have these individuals who will actually enter heaven before you, the religious who are now rebelling, that refuse to repent or recognize your error or recognize your hard-heartedness or however you want to call it. They have the inability to recognize that. Let's spend some time talking then about these two groups of people. First of all, the rebellious who repent. If you ask the religious people, and maybe that why this is like such a scathing response by Jesus, and maybe why it would incite anger in the hearts of these religious people like it does on various occasions in the New Testament, if you ask them, hey, are tax collectors and prostitutes going to be in heaven? And they would emphatically answer you, no. They don't deserve to be in heaven. They're not as good as us. Take the Pharisee and the tax collector in the temple praying as an example. The Pharisee says, look at me, I'm good, I do all these things right, I'm glad you didn't make me like him. And then the tax collector's in the corner hiding from everybody saying, God, I'm not worthy to be here. There's this stark contrast, but the emphasis in that text is on the Pharisee who's saying, there's me and them. And they don't deserve what I deserve because of what I do and who I am. And here Jesus says, these religious people, if you were to ask them, they would emphatically say, no, tax collectors and prostitutes have no place in heaven. So Jesus probably couldn't have chosen a more offensive way to tell the religious leaders that they are a long way off from the highway to heaven than by telling them tax collectors who skim off the top and prostitutes who live at the very bottom, basically, are further along the path to heaven than these religious people were. I hear that and I think about it, and it just makes me glad that whatever I do, how bad it is, how far off of God's path it is, even if I'm the lowest of the low, in the slums with the tax collectors of the world, figuratively speaking, and the prostitutes of the world, figuratively speaking, even if that's where I am spiritually, God's grace is available to even the worst of those people. You know, in 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 15, this is how Paul describes himself to Timothy, who was trying to make his way into ministry. He says, here is a trustworthy saying that deserves all of your attention and full acceptance. This is what he says. Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners, among whom I'm the worst, among whom I'm the chief. Like, there's nobody that was worse than me, and Jesus came even for me, as far off as I was, in the figurative slums like the tax collectors and the prostitutes of the world. Paul says, that was me. God uses the most extreme example to these religious elite people to show that God's grace goes deeper than all of our sins. That's a great, great passage of scripture to me, Matthew 21, 28 through 32, to show the depth of God's love. And you even think about passages like 1 Corinthians 6 and verse number 11, where Paul gets done at the first part of chapter 6 listing all of these heinous sins, like bad stuff, nasty stuff. You know how immoral Corinth was. All of these nasty things, and Paul says in 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 11, and such were some of you. That's how you lived. But because of Jesus, not anymore. The rebellious who repent. Second group right here. The religious who rebel. That's really the focus of the text anyway. Jesus was not so much talking about the rebellious who repent. He was just using them as an example to say, even the worst of people can see what you've missed and they let it change them and they do something about it. But you, on the other hand, you've missed it. You're like the religious who rebel. And he likens that essentially to the second son, whose response was empty, because he says, yes, I'll do it. Yes, I'll go. Yes, I'll go work in the vineyard. But he doesn't actually do anything. And the problem with these Pharisees and scribes and other religious leaders, and this is a constant problem. Think about two other places. Think about Matthew 15 and verse number 8, in which Jesus says, these people do honor me with their lips, but their what? Heart is far from me, is what Jesus says. They say all the right things, but their heart is far from me. Or in Matthew 23 and verse number 3, essentially Jesus says of the Pharisees, they don't practice what they preach. They're sound in doctrine, but not sound in practice. They say all the right things. They tell everybody all the right things. But what they do and what they say, they don't match up. And you think about how often that's true in our lives. Like how often the rebukes that Jesus gives to the Pharisees are evident in our own lives, because sometimes we fall more into the category of the religious who rebel than we do the rebellious who repent. It's like we look at other people and we compare ourselves to other people and we're like, well, at least I'm not like them. At least I'm not doing bad like them. At least my life looks better than them. And we say all the right things and we show up in all the right places. But really, like, we don't live it. It doesn't change us. And that's a constant problem, not just in, you know, our local churches, but just the world over. I heard a sermon on this parable in preparation for this lesson. And in that sermon, the guy asked four questions that were pretty tough questions to think about along the lines of this idea of the Pharisees and the scribes, religious people, basically, who said things, but their lives didn't match up to it. And he asked four questions. He says, how many times have you sung words of obedience? Like, take, for instance, the song Trust and Obey. Trust and obey, there's no other way to be happy in Jesus. How many times have you sang that in your career of being a Christian? I honestly wouldn't even begin to count. I think we sang it for every invitation song growing up. 7:14 in our book, Trust and Obey. It is what it is. How many times have we sang words of obedience? Trust and obey, there's no other way to be happy in Jesus than to trust and obey, and then do nothing in my faith to act on that which I professed. That when times get tough, the last thing I do is trust the Lord. Or when I'm put in a situation where I have to decide, am I going to do what God says or am I not? Most of the time it's not, and we don't obey. How many times do we say that, but we don't do it? Or what about this one? This was a question that made me think about it. And maybe you've been asked this question before. But how many times have you said to somebody something like this? I'll pray for you. And you don't pray for them. How many times? I'm praying for you. I'm praying for you. We say that to people. To their faces. We write it on their Facebook walls, but then we don't do anything about it. Like, we don't pray. Their name is never uttered out of our mouth before God. Third question, how many times have I asked God to open a door for me? And then when he opens the door, I don't go. Maybe it's because the door is not the one I thought God should have opened. Or maybe what's on the other side of the door looks different than what I thought should have been there. Or maybe I wasn't ready for the door. So, you know, I pray to God, open the door, but then it opens and I'm not ready. Or what about the times that I told God, I'll do better at serving you. God, I want to serve you. God, I'm going to give you my best in the tough times. Even when the tough times, and you start to do that, but when things get better, you just forget about it. Like, the service wanes. It disappears, essentially, when things get better, because you made a promise when times were tough, you're going to give your best, but then when everything got better, it all went away. Look what verse 32 says in the text. He said, John came to show you the way. Like, John showed you what was right and what was good, and you didn't believe him. Tax collectors and prostitutes, they did believe him. They were the low of the low. They were the rebellious, and they believed what John was saying about me. And their lives changed, but you didn't. You saw it. You didn't even change your mind, and you didn't believe him. They refused, Jesus says. And he points out that you should have been moved to action like the tax collectors and like the prostitutes. You should have been moved to action to change your life and to be transformed by the message of Jesus. But he says you didn't. Instead of repenting, you rebelled, essentially. You're fine in what you are. Even when you saw it, he says, you didn't change your mind and believe. You didn't repent, some of your Bibles might say, and believe. I point those things out maybe to just call our attention to some realities that just might be present in our lives today, that it is often the case that people that we deem as awful, nasty, worthless people, they appreciate what God offers through Jesus so much more sometimes than the best of us. And there's often an attitude that dominates the hearts and minds of the best of us that says, just because I go to church and just because I do these things and just because I have my life together and I don't sin like they do and my sins don't look like theirs do, that I got the golden ticket to heaven, that my mansion's going to be right beside Jesus's because I do all those things. And that's just not how it works. And that was the problem with Jesus and these people. He says, here you have people that truly appreciate what John said about me. And it let them they let it change their lives. But you, on the other hand, sure, you said the right things. You say, I'll go work for you, God. but you don't do it. Which of the two did the father's will? Well, it was the one who said by their life, figuratively speaking, because that's what tax collectors and prostitutes did. If they're pursuing collecting taxes like they did in Jesus' day, and if they're pursuing a life of prostitution, then basically what they're saying is no to Jesus. Yes to their sin and no to Jesus. I will not. But they came to their senses and they changed. They're the son number one. Son number two are the religious people that say, oh, yes, we'll do it. I'll pray for you. Oh, I go to church. I do all the right things. But then their actions don't necessarily match up. Two different groups of people. Maybe I need to think about where I am. Am I someone who recognizes the depth of my sin and the need that I have for Jesus? And I'm willing to let him transform me and let him change me. Or am I kind of like the person who says, but I do all the right things. And I say all these good things, but I'm not necessarily one who lives it out in my life. One other thing I guess I'd like to do in the time that we have remaining, and I'll have to kind of go through it a little bit quick as time runs out, but I want to go back to where we started. We started talking about dads, right? I gave you those two little silly jokes about dads. I don't want it to be lost on us what is revealed about the father in this text. You know, sometimes we talk about the sons, right? The sons, he says, you have one son that said no, and then he eventually did it. You had another son that said yes and didn't do anything. But I don't want the message of the father to be lost on us either. Because at the end of the day, if we read these parables or any story in the scripture, for that matter, and we don't come away with a deeper love for the Father, then we've done it wrong. We've missed it. If we don't love Jesus more and God more and the Spirit more for what they revealed to us about themselves in these messages, it's not just lessons that expose the sinfulness of our heart. That's not why the Bible was written. It's not just to say you need to fix this and do better, but it makes us want to love Jesus more too. So what can we learn about the Father? There are five things that caught my attention just from reading the text and the exchange that the father had with these kids. The first one is the father loves you. The father loves you. He's fond of you. He desires to have a relationship with you. And I know that because he calls him son. It's like God could have said, the father could have said, hey, go do work in the vineyard. But instead he chose to reassure him with this term of endearment and affection. Son, I'm asking you to do this, something that's profitable for you. Work in the vineyard needed to be done, and the son probably needed to learn some responsibility to do something. And there's a way to communicate that shows no affection or compassion, and there's a way to do that shows affection and compassion. And he said, son, I need you to do this. He was expressing to him the care and concern that he has for him. And I think that's worth pointing out, that the Father does love us and he does ask us to do stuff. There is work to be done. We know that. And the way that we involve ourselves in the work is different in Starla's life than it is in Phillip's and mine. Like, we all involve ourselves in the work in a different way, but the reality is work needs to be done. God's told us that. But the way he communicated his desire for us to do that work is exactly that. Son, daughter, I love you. And I'm giving you this stuff. I'm giving you these jobs, these tasks, these guidelines and expectations because I love you and I want the best for you. If you ever doubt God's love, there's probably a lot of passages you can turn to. You know, maybe even if you type passages about God's love in Google, you would probably get maybe like 1 John 4, right? Or maybe John 3:16, or maybe Romans 5 and verse 6, or Romans 5 and verse 8. Let me give you another one to write down. I like to read this one from time to time. It's Zephaniah 3. Zephaniah 3 and verse 17, and here's what it says. The Lord your God is with you. He's mighty to save. He delights in you. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. I think about that. Even just the phrase, he will take delight in you. And I thought about it this way. You know, moms are this way, usually. It's not usually dads. I'm not saying that it isn't the case that dads do this, but it's moms usually like this. And I could have the worst possible round of golf of my whole high school golf career and walk off the course, and even my teammates knew how bad I played, and then my coach was telling me, man, we need to get on the range, we need to fix this, and I'm mad because it was awful, and you can bet on mama, that was so good, you did so good, you know, that was the best little round of golf I've ever seen, right? And she don't have a clue what happened, but she delights in me. It doesn't matter the outcome of the situation. It doesn't matter how bad golf, that she could care less about that. She delights in me, right? Even Ashley said on the bus yesterday, if y'all lose, it's okay. I'm like, no, you know? No, we want to win, right? But the reality is, Ashley would have been happy with us either way. And a lot of other people would have too. And that's the truth about our lives. Like, we have people in our lives that regardless of the circumstance, whether we win or lose ball games, win or lose situations, win or lose health battles, it doesn't matter. People delight in you. On a more grand scale, God does. He delights in you. He loves you. He loves you. And that's why he has expectations for us, because he loves you. The second thing is, in this text, what do we learn about the Father? Well, the Father's will is that we work. While he loves us and while he expresses that love for us, it's not a passive receptivity of that love. It's not, oh, God loves me, so I won't do anything. But the response to that love is to reciprocate it in such a way that says, man, I'm going to do what you asked me to do. I want to serve you. I want to give back to you because you love me. And that's what he says. Son, go work. Son, an expression of authority and affection, but I have a job for you to do. And we know that God has work for us to do. A Christian who's not working is like a contradiction in and of itself. We know how many passages in the New Testament are put forth as this standard of service. Like, this is what you're expected to do work. 1 Peter 4 and verse 10, I think it is. Peter says, each one of you should use the gift that you've received to serve other people. That's the expectation of God, is to use the gifts that you've served. In fact, he even says, if I remember right, faithfully upholding the grace of God. Like, the way that you faithfully uphold God's grace given to you is if you use the gifts that he gave you to serve other people. The Father's will is that we work. Don't miss that. Number three, what do we learn about the Father in the text? The Father expects obedience, or immediate obedience, you could say. Notice the urgency in verse 28. My son, I love you. Go work. There's something for you to do, but go work in the vineyard today. Like, go work. Don't wait until a more convenient season, like you read in the book of Acts with Felix. Or don't wait until you feel like, do it today. Like Hebrews 3 and verse 15. The Hebrews writer says, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Essentially, you're going to hear God's voice. If you have a willing ear, respond today. Don't put it off. Or 2 Corinthians 6 and verse 2, Paul says, I tell you now, today is the day of salvation. Tomorrow may be too late, we sing sometimes. Like, we see the New Testament and the urgency it puts on things like salvation. We want to respond. I want to get my life right today because I know it might be too late. The same thing about the work that the Father expects us to do. If I'm a Christian and I'm faithfully serving the Lord, I recognize the love that he has for me and the expectation that he has for me to work, I'm not going to want to put that off another day. I'm going to dive into serving the Lord today. Number four, the Father wants to be gracious. The Father wants to be gracious. I want you to think about this in the later part of the text, like in verse number 31 and on into verse 32, where he talks about the tax collectors and the prostitutes. Like, God loves to redeem failures. He likes to take broken, messed up things and make them into nothing. And even Paul tells Timothy that. He says, you have these vessels of honor and vessels of dishonor. You have these gold and silver. He said, I just want to be a vessel fit for the master's use. I don't have to be fancy or gold. I just want to be used, right? I just want to be used. And that's the idea. God loves to do that. And the reason I know that he wants to be gracious is because it probably takes time for a tax collector to change his mind or ways. And even a prostitute, probably takes some time. In fact, you see that in the New Testament where Jesus calls a tax collector, Matthew, and he gets up and he goes, but there was probably some baggage associated with his now transition into following Jesus. Probably some things that it didn't just happen overnight where things immediately got better. What about Zacchaeus? Zacchaeus says, I'm going to go follow you, a tax collector that Jesus called. Like, Jesus wants to be gracious, even to the worst of people. But do you know why he was so harsh with the Pharisees? Why would he say the tax collectors and the prostitutes, they're on the road to heaven before you? In fact, it says in verse 31, they are entering the kingdom before you. I think the Greek reads, they are entering the kingdom ahead of you. It's almost like if we're all running the race and we're on the road to heaven right now, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are up there and you're way back here. Why would Jesus tell them that? Because he wants them to change. He's not just saying that so they'll feel bad about themselves. He's saying, I'm telling you this because I want you to have what they have. I want to be gracious to you. He says in 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 9, God is long-suffering. He's patient, not willing that any should perish, but what? All should come to repentance. He wants to be gracious. Lesson number five about the Father from Matthew 21, 28 through 32. He desires repentance, not self-righteous, ritualistic religion, but he wants true repentance, true change, true humility, true sorrow, true recognition of the depths of our sin. Not just saying, I'm going to change, I'm going to do better, I'm going to fix this, and there's no action. No change, no change of mind, no change of heart, no change of action. Samuel, in 1 Samuel 15, he recorded these words. He said, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed is better than the fat of rams. He's saying you could offer all of these things, really, and it mean nothing, but to actually obey and to listen and to embrace, it's better than anything you could say or offer. It's actually putting the rubber on the road. There's a difference, someone said, between wishing and willing. You can wish for a change, but until you're willing to embrace the will of God, wishing will never get you there. What you do, we said at the beginning, is more important than what you say. Jesus had aught with the Pharisees and the scribes and all the other religious folks that constantly honored God with their lips, but their actions never added up. Perhaps the reason why so many people would never, ever, ever obey the gospel is because of the problem, like we put on this last screen, the two categories of people. That there are a lot of rebellious people who would be willing to repent, but they won't because of the religious who rebel. They'll never, ever change their hearts or thoughts or mind toward God because of all the people who say good things about Christianity, but they never do anything about it. Maybe our challenge for us is, how can I make sure that doesn't happen in my own life? How can I be a person who lives out what I claim to believe? I want to commit to Jesus Christ, be humble, and truly change, and let that change the lives of other people. Any question or comment on Matthew 28, 21, 28 through 32? All right. Appreciate your kind attention. I guess we'll get ready for our devotional.